I invite you to follow along in the order of service. For those of you attending virtually, all the links for this service, including the order of service, are on our website and in this morning's worship service email. If you are here in the sanctuary this morning, please silence your cell phones. My name is Michael Woods. I married into KUUF over 10 years ago. I very much enjoy listening to Brian Kenny's piano skills and Joseph Bednarik's voice. Very happy to be here this morning. Our worship leader, Joseph Bednarik, is a publisher at Copper Canyon Press in Port Townsend and a frequent speaker here at KUUF. We're glad to have Joseph back with us this morning. I'd like to welcome any visitors. If you are here in person, we all would love to welcome you outside after the service. If you are attending virtually, please introduce yourselves after the service at our Zoom coffee hour. Everyone is welcome to attend our Zoom coffee hour directly after the service. The link is in the email that went out this morning and will show on your screen following the worship service. You may need to use the password coffee with a capital C to be admitted to the coffee hour. The announcements are available on our website, www.kuuf.org, or in our weekly email newsletter, The Candle. We acknowledge that the land on which we gather is the Aboriginal territory of the Suquamish people. Expert fishermen, canoe builders, and basket weavers, the Suquamish live in harmony with the lands and waterways along Washington's Central Salish Sea, as they have for thousands of years. Here, the Suquamish live and protect the land and waters of their ancestors for future generations, as promised by the Point Elliott Treaty of 1855. Please stand as you're willing and able to sing our musical call to worship, hymn number 118 in our gray hymnal, This Little Light of Mine. Today's opening words are contained within a very short sentence from the Buddha. Your work is to discover your work, and then, with all your heart, give yourself to it. Join me now in lighting our chalice. If you have your own chalice or candle at home, please light it with us. We light the chalice this morning with these words from Plotinus. We may think of the divine as a fire whose outgoing warmth pervaded the universe. Please join me in the spoken affirmation. The words will appear on the screen. We gather as a caring community, seeking life's deeper meanings. We value diversity and affirm the worth of all living things. We strive to speak truth in love, to act for justice, to grow in spirit, and to care for the earth. We celebrate with open hearts and minds the creative power that sustains and transforms us. Now Melinda Hughes, our Director of Religious Education, will share our time for all ages.
Thanks. Good morning, everyone. So Tanisha and Brian, there aren't any children here, so I think we're probably going to skip the children's recessional and just go into the hymn when we're done. So there are children here. They're just already up at the Matin building, just so you know. I think there's five of them up there, six of them up there right now. They're just youngins. So today I'm going to share the story with you, the same author as last week, Kobe Yamada. He's from Seattle. And this story is titled, Maybe. Have you ever wondered why you are here? You are the only you there ever has been or ever will be. You have so much to offer. Maybe you will invent something that no one has ever seen before. Maybe you will build things that reach high into the sky. Your life is yours. Try as many things as you can try. See as much as you can see. Wherever you go, take your hopes, pack your dreams, and never forget. It is on journeys that discoveries are made. Maybe you will help others to see the beauty in each day. Or maybe you will lift cheering crowds onto their feet. Do everything with love. Follow your heart and see where it leads you. Maybe you are here to shine a light into places that have been dark for far too long. Maybe you will speak up for those who can't speak for themselves. Maybe you are here to help in ways that only you can. There will be struggles, there will be fears, and it won't always be easy. At times, it will feel really hard, and you might make a mess of things. You may fall down. You may fail. But you will also get back up, and you will rise a little stronger and a little taller, because there really is more inside you than you know. And this world needs your gifts, your talents, your big ideas. And maybe you are just getting started. What if you are only scratching the surface of what you can do and who you can be? What if you have talents you haven't discovered yet? There is something powerful, even magical, about you. You already have everything it takes to do big things. Maybe you have no idea just how good you really can be. And maybe you don't know how much you matter. But maybe, just maybe, the world has been waiting centuries for someone exactly like you. One thing is for sure, you are here. And because you are here, anything is possible. So, skipping with the children's recessional, we will go into the hymn, How Can I Keep From Singing? I believe the words are going to be on the screen.
Now it is time for our morning offering. If your offering is for KUUF, please put it into the envelopes in the baskets. Loose change, cash, or checks placed in the basket will go to this month's charitable giving recipient, Bremerton Food Line. If this is your first time at KUUF, you are our guest and there is no need to contribute. Let there be an offering to strengthen and sustain our community, which is sacred to so many of us. Let's enjoy a gift of music from our pianist, Brian Kenny. Now is the time for our joys and sorrows. When shared together, our joys are amplified and our sorrows lessened. Terry Looney has a joy to share. They experienced a wonderful visit from their Massachusetts son, Craig, daughter-in-law, Gwen, and grandson, Jesse, last week. Karen Leader Scott has a sorrow. Susan Scott's brother, Patrick, died yesterday. Thoughts of love and comfort with Susan. We light a candle of gratitude and love from Nancy Slate for everyone who helped make Ed Wood's service yesterday a true celebration of his life and all that he meant to his family and friends. She is so thankful that they were able to share 35 years together. And Ginny Sugimoto and Catherine and I share a joy that today is Mark Masao Sugimoto's 65th birthday. May he live long and prosper. We light one last candle for those joys and sorrows that are still too tender to share. Please join me in a moment of prayer or intention. In the spirit of community, in which we find strength and common purpose, we share our joys, our sorrows, our hopes, and dreams. We have turned our minds and hearts toward one another in trust, giving love, seeking comfort, and celebrating together. We are part of the web of life that makes us one with all humanity, one with all the universe. In all the moments of our lives, for those loved ones and events shared this morning, and for those we yet hold in the silence of our hearts, we are truly grateful for the love and support of this beloved community. May the spirit of life and love bring peace to us all. Amen and blessed be. Please remain seated as we sing Spirit of Life, hymn number 123, in our gray hymnal. For those at home, the words will appear on your screen.
Everybody. It is so great to be back at KUUF. Missed last month. I've been on the road for 3 weeks. Two Sundays ago, I was at my mom's church in Western New York, this beautiful Lutheran cathedral, and I took communion, which was wonderful. And then last week, I was actually at a Latin Mass in Montreal. It's something that I've always wanted to do. I've never been to a Latin Mass. And my wife and daughter, who I was traveling with, deigned to rent bicycles, and we pedaled across town to go to a Latin Mass. It was quite extraordinary. I didn't understand a word. But I was there. And so it's just such a wonderful thing to be back in a sanctuary that feels like home. So thanks for here. The reading this morning is a prose poem. A little longer than I usually read. It's called Bunchgrass. It's from a book called Bunchgrass, and this is poem number 37. by a Northwest poet named Robert Sund. And just to give you a little context so you can easily understand what's going on, Sund is a young poet. He's traveled to Eastern Washington to work the harvests there. So he's an intellectual, a poet, a creative person hanging out with farmers and ranchers and workers and getting into conversations and discussions with them. And this is a particularly poignant poem where he's meeting a man for the first time. Bunchgrass 37 by Robert Sund. The ranchers are selling their wheat early this year, not holding it over for a better price in the spring. Next year, the government lifts restrictions on planting, and nobody is sure what will happen when wheat grows fence row to fence row. This morning, another man has come out from the grain growers to help us out. John and I haven't the time to cooper boxcars and handle trucks, too. At lunchtime, he takes his carpenter's apron off and sits on a grain door in the shade of a boxcar, resting before he eats. I go out to join him and notice a Bible resting on a ledge under the rear window of his car. He says he doesn't read it much, and because he is anxious not to appear narrowly Christian, I want to know more about him. He's 65, about to retire, a lonely man, it seems. There is something unspoken in him. His eyes squint to keep out the bright sunlight falling now just where the boxcar's shadow stops. I say, there's one thing in Mark that has always puzzled me. He turns to face me, and I continue. Where Jesus says, to them that have shall be given, and from them that have not shall be taken away. That always seemed cruel to me. But since the verb hasn't got an object, have what, have not what, if you supply an object, it's really alive, like love, money, intelligence, curiosity, anything. In the bleached countryside of his mind, suddenly a new season washes over. Common plants begin to blossom, and now ideas fly back and forth between us like bees, their legs thickening with pollen. In the next hour, we talk a lot, and I learn that he has been reading Rufus Jones, Meister Eckhart, and the Cloud of Unknowing. He nearly trembles with joy, with a new joy that he has kept hidden. His wife writes poetry, he tells me, and adds, thrusting years recklessly aside, I've worked here 16 years, one harvest to another. I've seen a lot of young men come and go and never had a decent conversation. It's worse with the college kids. They don't think, most of them. Trucks start coming in again. Lunch is over. He puts his carpenter's apron on again, but before we part, he invites me home to dinner this evening, careful not to spoil it by appearing as happy as he really is. Back inside the elevator, I'd like to lie down somewhere in a cool, dark corner and weep. What are people doing with their lives? What are they doing? Please enter a time of silent meditation. We are very, very fortunate to sit in a sanctuary with Brian behind the keyboards. They're fantastic. And wow, I was thinking, as I was sitting there, I realized, wow, I went to a Lutheran church and a Latin mass. It's like I just encompassed the entire Protestant Reformation, you know? And now I'm at a Unitarian Universalist church where it's like completely shattered, which is beautiful. Anyway, I hope everyone is successfully navigating and negotiating our global pandemic, that daily obstacle course. As I mentioned, I just returned from 3 weeks on the road on the East Coast, where I took planes and trains and boats and subways and cars, which brought me to airports and train stations and subway stops and church services and restaurants and hotels, a circus, some museums, and a high school reunion. And I can report that I was always, as in always, in the minority of those wearing masks, which is to say that we are all currently living our lives within a global pandemic that is both very personal and incredibly public. And as our pandemic hurtles deeper into its third year, we realize, I hope, that our lives are composed entirely of time. And at the end of the day, no pun intended, all we have is our time. And by living our lives within this insidious thread of a global pandemic and facing the cold reality that in the middle of the summer here in 2022, over 6.4 million people around the world have had their time end because of the pandemic. So many of us are viscerally aware of time. And there is every reason on earth to become deeply, fiercely, wonderfully aware of time. And truth be told, there's always been every reason on earth to be keenly aware of time, though living within a pandemic, at least for me, has catalyzed the process in a big way. And the case in point, the so-called Great Resignation. According to a segment that aired on 60 Minutes, 20 million Americans left their jobs in the second half of 2021. Now, an economist who works for the social media platform LinkedIn says, quote, "People have been living to work for a very long time. And I think that the pandemic brought that moment of reflection for everyone. What do I want to do? What makes my heart sing?" And people are thinking, if now, if not now, then when? Which gracefully segues to an email I received on winter solstice, on the darkest day of the year. And this is from in the Northern Hemisphere. Very Unitarian Universalist thing to note, by the way, right? Winter solstice isn't the shortest day of the year. It's the longest, says those in Antarctica. This for someone I've known for over 30 years. They are in their mid-70s. They live near Philadelphia. And they write, quote, "I don't know about you," the email begins, "but I am too often finding myself to be unhappy about my own future. I have, according to my genetic background and the medical world we all live in now, a good while to continue living in this world, probably 20 years at least, and I don't want those years to be for naught. But at the moment, I'm not doing anything worthwhile." And it's important to note that that phrase, "I'm not doing anything worthwhile," in the email was bolded for emphasis. And again, I continue on with my friend's words, quote, "I wish I could return to the classroom, even the elementary school one where I started, but that would not be good for anyone. I think I'm just too far from what kids expect and need now, and let me know if you disagree. But I don't want to spend the next 20 years just hanging out and doing nothing of any value to society at large. So I'm writing to pretty much everyone I know to see whether you have any useful ideas. I volunteer now at Meals on Wheels, at Carpenter's Hall, but I would like to feel more useful. There must be many good ways to spend my time. So I'm writing to pretty much everyone I know to ask for ideas. And when I've heard from enough people to have something useful to say, I will probably write again to tell you the ideas that have been sent. Cheers. Now, I honored my friend's communique, and I gave his request a lot of thought. And like a prayer bead, I started turning that word worthwhile over and over. Worthwhile, worthwhile, worthwhile. And I finally heard that obvious welding job, right? The fusion of two distinct words, worth and while, value and period of time. I realize that it's a small point, and I completely understand if you are underwhelmed by that insight, though I do admit a similar aha moment when I realized that community was also a welding job of common and unity. And when you want your life to be worthwhile, you are longing to have your time, your life, be of value. And my friend's email clearly stated that they deeply, deeply desire what they are doing in their life to be worthwhile to the common unity. When they state, I don't want to spend the next 20 years just hanging out and doing nothing of any value to society at large. And what frequently happens to me when I begin thinking about an issue, when I begin feeling my way through an emotional labyrinth, when I start worrying words like prayer beads, worthwhile, worthwhile, the world starts to send me messages. Right? I trust that this happens to some, if not most of you. And wouldn't you know it, shortly after receiving my friend's email with that bolded statement, I'm not doing anything worthwhile, I received what I considered to be a sign from the universe. I was invited to the pre-sale of an estate sale for a psychologist who was recently admitted to a memory care facility. Now, at this sale, I was entirely alone in his garage. The tables held the usual stuff, you know, kitchenware and Scrabble games, binoculars, needle-nose pliers, and among all that stuff was a vintage Swiss stopwatch. This stopwatch. Feel like that scene from Pulp Fiction, right? This watch. Now, I recognized instantly as a piece of art. It's old school. It's analog. It's in perfect condition. Felt great in the hands. And it has fantastic typography on the face of the watch. I wound it. I engaged the mechanism, I held the watch to my ear, and there was that very recognizable and it continues to be the best $5 that I've spent in 2022. Now, once at home, I started keeping that stopwatch in my office, visible and within arm's reach. This entire sermon was composed with that stopwatch ticking away, and I am deeply, deeply satisfied when I wind that watch. And I feel the ratcheted clicking, the necessary tension. Note that, the necessary tension. And imagining the inner workings, those minute springs and sprockets and flywheels and the hearing of that telltale ticking, the second hand sweeping around and around that large dial and this minute hand marking time within a smaller dial. I highly encourage you to come up and take a peek. And then I noticed that throughout my workday, sometimes the ticking was audible. I was very aware of that watch, the presence of that watch. But when I got engaged, the ticking all but disappeared. And so for me, this gorgeous stopwatch from the estate of a PhD psychologist whose memory is calving like a melting glacier became a talisman as I tried to figure out how to respond to my friend. Because my friend's email was all about value, human value, all about time, the value within time, usefulness, and life, how to bring the two together. And it calls forth these cold realities and these incredibly deep mysteries and a profound personal relationship that we all have with time. And I'll consider this another sign that I had just this morning. I was in the parking lot prior to the service, and I met a visitor who's here for the first time, and he mentioned that he survived his own little brush with death, no, probably big brush with death, and he's thinking deeply about time. And so here we are in the presence of someone who is taking the next step into their life with this great gift of their time. So welcome. And the stopwatch also has one profoundly motivating and powerful and clarifying superpower. It reminds us that time is moving ceaselessly forward in one direction, although, footnote, the mystics among us would probably argue the point. But for me, it brings to mind that chorus from the Steve Miller Band song, Fly Like an Eagle. You know, we've all heard it on the road trips. Fly like an eagle, time keeps on slipping into the future. I heard you guys. And so with a second hand sweeping around that dial and with the ticking audible in various degrees, I admire how my friend is reaching out to his common unity with vulnerability, incredible vulnerability, to crowdsource ideas, help me. You know, it is a brave act to send a mass email with an honest assessment and bolded in your email. I am not doing anything worthwhile. And then to articulate those specific activities that they are engaged in, right? Delivering meals to the elderly, serving as a docent at a history museum, and then the statement, I would like to feel more useful. I would like to feel more useful. What incredible longing there is in that sentence. And I read that part of the letter, I immediately thought of this poem that I know has been verbalized in this sanctuary, Marge Piercy's famous poem, To Be of Use. And I'd like to read it here. To Be of Use by Marge Piercy. The people I love best jump into work headfirst without dallying in the shallows and swim off with sure strokes almost out of sight. They seem to become natives of that element, the black, sleek heads of seals bouncing like half-submerged balls. I love people who harness themselves, an ox, to a heavy cart, who pull like water buffalo with massive patience, who strain in the mud and the muck to move things forward, who do what has to be done again and again. I want to be with people who submerge in the task, who go into the fields to harvest and work in a row and pass the bags along, who are not parlor generals and field deserters, but move in a common rhythm when the food must come in or a fire be put out. The work of the world is as common as mud. Botched, it smears the hands and crumbles to dust. But the thing worth doing well done has a shape that satisfies, clean and evident. Greek amphoras for wine or oil, Hopi vases that held corn are put in museums, but you know they were made to be used. The pitcher cries for water to carry, and a person for work that is real. And so with a pitcher crying for water and a friend who is searching for work that is real, We have, as of yet, no crisp list of options, no organizations where they can volunteer their time, no complicated problem that their particular genius can solve. There's no practical advice, no guidance. And in fact, upon careful review, my friend's email did not ask for advice, did not ask for guidance. They asked for ideas. Now, the reason that we have no practical ideas is because the question at bedrock is more spiritual than practical. And I have a great suspicion that my friend, who is a devout and fierce rational humanist, does not want to hear that the problem is a spiritual one, though I'm going to say it anyway. So to close, here is what I sent to my friend after some prelude. Idea number one. Think back over your life and recollect those books and movies, the songs and plays, the statues and the paintings where you have had a strong emotional reaction, joy, anger, tears, where you were moved emotionally beyond your fencing brain to a place where your heart cracked wide open. What on earth was going on here? If you are uncomfortable with this exercise and wish to dismiss the notion out of hand, you're exactly where you need to be. What does this information tell you about yourself? And how can you use this information to help guide you toward real work that has worth in your while? Idea number two. Do yourself a favor and read Ross Gay's glorious The Book of Delights at least twice, once front to back and then once back to front. And then for the third time, have that be a forever time. Just have the book nearby, open it at random and read it again. It is a breezy and profound reading experience. And for those of you taking notes at home, the book again, Ross Gay's The Book of Delights. And do yourself another favor. Mark up the pages, jot notes, starring and underlining and exclamation pointing to your heart's content right there on the pages. The experience will ground you in the real world with an eye toward gratitude and an eye toward appreciation. And you might consider starting Gray's simple practice for yourself, writing down each day some specific object or experience that you were grateful for. We all find it super easy to slide into complaining. What are you grateful for? As the jacket copy on the book reads, quote, "The small joys we often overlook in our busy lives. There are huge and vastly complicated problems in the world that you will never solve. Making a practice of saying hello to the small joys can be deeply nourishing." And idea number three. Savor the impossible miracle of your very existence. There is absolutely no mathematical reason, playing to his rational humanism, there is absolutely no mathematical reason why you should be here, and yet here you are. The same holds true for the elderly woman for whom you deliver lunch in your service for Meals on Wheels. Together, you both, two impossible miracles linked in a common unity of a needed meal. What you're doing here is one of the simplest, most invisible, and loving acts imaginable. My guess is when you deliver meals, you are delivering meals to some of the loneliest people on planet Earth who are closer than they would actually like to be to the void. Their sweeping secondhand on their watch is very, very near to stopping, and they will soon not be here forever. So while their hand is still warm, take it into yours. Listen to a story or two. Truly listen. There is so much worth in that while. And when her story ends and a bit of silence enters the room, perhaps you will feel brave. And perhaps you will share with her, with this grand and beautiful, this hungry widow, something that you witnessed just a few minutes ago on the way to her apartment. Crossing guard in a reflector vest, stopping traffic so that a small group of little kids could safely cross a busy street. Yours was the first car stopped in a growing line of cars as you watched this crosswalk scene. And rather than be annoyed and impatient, something that you frequently do, something inside you invited to be amazed and to be grateful, to watch and to see a crossing guard, a fellow human being, someone in your common unity, doing something very worthwhile and very, very real. Amen. If you are willing and able at this point in the service, we invite you to rise for our closing hymn in the teal hymnal. Someone told me I pronounced hymnal wrong. Hymnal. It's hymnal. Apologies. Hymn number 1024, When the Spirit Says Do, and the words will also appear on the screen.
You got to do when the Spirit
Those of you who were reading in the hymnal, there's a note that says, replace do with other words, sing, dance, laugh, shout, etc. So this song could literally be infinite, because there's always stuff to do. It's like, let's stop singing right now, because I don't want to do anything. Anyway, so after the service today, in honor of our global pandemic, if you would please exit to the outside and greet people outside. There's going to be coffee and tea in the foyer. Enjoy conversations out there. For those of you who are attending online, there's a coffee hour immediately following the service, and the password, capital C, coffee. Our closing words this morning, no surprise, a beautiful little poem by Antonio Machado. Beyond living and dreaming, what matters most is waking up. And we extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, the fire of commitment, the power of transformation. These let us carry in our hearts until we're together again. Now please enjoy Brian Kenny's postlude.